Well, good morning. It's good to see all of you here this morning. And if you didn't notice, there's a baby! Yeah. Would you like to introduce him to the congregation? Camden Michael. Welcome, Camden. We will let him know that we are nice people. And I will gladly compete with that noise for a bit. So there is a lot going on in the life of the church this week, so please take a second and look through the bulletin. If you didn't pick one up, you can grab one as you go, just to remind you some of the things that are happening and ways that you can participate. So if you are interested in becoming involved in some of the mission activities or Bible studies or things like that, just take a look at the bulletin or at the newsletter, and that will let you know so that you can be more involved if that is what you would like, and to grow in fellowship with one another. There is just a couple of announcements that I would like to highlight, and that is that next Sunday is World Communion Sunday. It is set aside as a special day of communion, and we will be celebrating that here as our regular Communion Sunday, but we will be singing some different songs and saying some different prayers, being very mindful of the fact that we are joined together by the Holy Spirit with all the saints, even those who are worshiping in different languages and at different times, but still we are bound together. And then also next Sunday, we have four new members to officially welcome into our fellowship, and we will do that next Sunday. It seems appropriate on a Communion Sunday to do that. And then we will also be taking a special offering next week for the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance Program. That is the ministry that is kind of the boots on the ground ministry whenever there is disasters here in the United States and around the world. Right now, there is an emphasis on helping the folks in Haiti after the earthquake, and then on the tropical storm and hurricane relief along the southern Gulf Coast. And so we will be taking a special offering next week for that. And you can please just make a note on your check or your donation or your offering that's what, you know, what amount you want to go to the disaster assistance, so it will help our counters to make sure things end up where you intend them to go. This is a beautiful day to be together, to worship and to fellowship and to pray and offer our thanks and our concerns. So as we prepare our hearts to worship, let's celebrate that we are here bound together by the Holy Spirit as the family of God. Let's prepare our hearts to worship.
For our prelude this morning, and the sermon topic is pray for each other. And I thought, oh, what a great topic. And I thought, well, I started thinking about all the songs that have to do with prayer, and there's a whole bunch of them. And then I thought, oh, maybe let's sing together one verse of Sweet Hour of Prayer, and then we can sing a lullaby. It'll be a lullaby to this sweet little boy here, this little miracle.
Thank you.
say that since Pastor Llewellyn has been here, she has instituted little times in the service where there's a short prayer. It might be a prayer before she reads a scripture, prayer for illumination, other little prayers. And I really appreciate that. This is the place, we can pray anywhere, obviously, but this is just the place when we're together, that we raise those prayers and our desires, our needs, our expectations, we raise those to God as well, and that's so appropriate. So now let's join together in our responsive call to worship. If it had not been for God, who was on our side, we would have fallen prey to those who want to harm us. We would have been swept away by sadness and fear. Blessed be the Lord, our protector. God has broken the snare that took away our freedom. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Blessed be God's holy name. Now let's stand and sing our opening hymn, I Sing the Mighty Power of God.
I sing the
Scripture reminds us that all of us have sinned and come short of God's glory, but it also tells us that God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so knowing this, we can approach God with confidence, knowing that God's grace is greater than all our sins. But we do come together to acknowledge that we are not God. And there are times whenever we stray from God's will and God's desire for our lives. So we pause to confess our sins together with one voice as human beings and then silently as individuals. So let's now confess our sins together. God of unity, we live in a world where our lives move between inclusivity and exclusivity. We often move toward the latter, trying to oust from our circles those who do not think like us, act like us, or look like us. Forgive our need to reject and to always be on the lookout for things that make us different. Give us the eyes of our teacher who knows unconditional love and compassion and sees us all as one. For it is in his name we pray. And let's pause for a time of silent confession. And let all God's children say, Amen. Sisters and brothers, friends and family, hear the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Hallelujah and Amen. Please be seated. As we prepare our hearts and minds for a time of prayer, I just would invite you to remember those who are on our prayer list and those especially who are grieving and are in need of healing and wholeness, whether it is those who are suffering from COVID and its effects, or others we know who are in need of healing. Let's pause for a time of silent prayer, and then I will lead us. Let's pray. We are grateful, O gracious God, for your word that comes to us in the form of the scriptures and especially in Jesus. We are grateful today that we will hear words about the power of prayer to heal and to bring reconciliation. Knowing that, O God, we pray that you watch over your creation and all that is in it, from the smallest creature to the most complex. We pray that you will help us to be good stewards of the beauty of this earth so that it can be passed on from generation to generation, so that people can look at all that you have made and wonder about who you might be and the God who spoke it into being. We pray, O God, for our community, for our neighbors, those whom we know and those whom we have not yet met. We pray that in this community we will be a voice of grace and mercy, that people can come to this place and that we can reach out to them where they are, to speak words of kindness and encouragement, and perhaps bring healing and wholeness to them as we speak your words of truth and show them your love. We pray for our nation and its leaders and the leaders around the world who hold the fate of so many in their hands. We pray that they will be guided by your wisdom and that your justice and your peace will ring true and be embodied and lived out in this world. We pray for peace to come to all those places that are in conflict, whether they are in someone's home or whether they are played out on a national or international scale. We pray, O God, for your peace to reign in our hearts and in our world. We pray for all those who labor today who do not know what it is to have a day of rest. Help us to make this day special, to remember that it is your day and that it is a sacred act to carve out time to rest and also to allow others to rest from their labors. And finally, O God, we pray that you will make us a people of prayer, that we will always seek you out with our joys and praise and thanksgivings as well as our concerns. We ask all of these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Song sing of God's amazing grace. May your feet be firm and steady in this race. When the world reflects your image through a mirrored facade, may you always see your beauty through the perfect eyes of God. This I pray, this I pray, that you'd have God's best, be strong and blessed. When your arms are empty, may your heart be full. When your mountains that you face seem impossible, when the ground is dry, I pray that you'd have rain. And when the music starts to vanish, you would sing on through the pain. This I pray, this I pray, that you'd have God's best, be strong and blessed. And when God's word is silent, hold tighter to his hand, and trust he'll lead you safely on the journey he has planned. And when threadbare dreams have still, when threadbare faith holds stillborn dreams, I pray the hurt would be redeemed. Hold on tighter to the Savior, grow in truth and never waver. I pray your heart is warm when life can be so cold, and when scoffers mock your journey, you'd be bold. I pray for food on your table in time when it's lean, and that you'd share your meal with others so God's goodness can be seen. This I pray, this I pray, this I pray, this I pray, that you'd have God's best, be strong and blessed. That you'd have God's best, be strong and blessed.
What a beautiful blessing. Thank you. And let's pray. Gracious God, as we prepare to hear your word read and proclaimed, we pray that you still our hearts and our minds so that we can hear your spirit speak to us as we draw close to you. In Christ we pray, amen. Our gospel lesson today comes from Mark chapter 9, verses 38 through 50. John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us. But Jesus said, 'Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterwards to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. For if any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It's better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourself and be at peace with one another." And our epistle lesson this morning comes from James chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. "Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you will be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Several years ago, my sister-in-law was a social worker for a hospice community. And she herself is a woman of faith, and it was especially helpful when she was working with people who were facing their own death, and to people who were struggling with grief and acceptance that their loved one was going to die. Regardless of the other person's faith, she felt it was very helpful that she had her own faith because she could offer comfort in ways that perhaps she couldn't otherwise. But she shared that one of the most surprising experiences that she had was whenever she would meet Christians, people of professed faith in Christ, who were overwhelmed with guilt because their loved ones were facing a terminal illness. They blamed themselves for their loved ones' impending death because they believed their faith was not enough to save their loved one. If they only had stronger faith, then God would heal their parent or their spouse or their sister or brother. If they had better prayer lives, if they were without sin, if they were more righteous, then their loved one would be healed and would not die. Now, my sister-in-law was shocked and saddened because she thought of all the times in our lives, it is at death that our faith should actually cradle us as we go from one life to the next. And those of us who are left behind can find that same sense of being cradled in the love and grace of our supportive faith community, loving us through the difficult time and propping us up with God's loving spirit. Now, my sister-in-law, in addition to being an MSW, is also a seminary graduate and a preacher's kid. And she was really frustrated by this because she said, you know, it's just so awful that we who try to follow Christ can take one little piece of scripture, and she pointed to this passage in James about healing. If you are righteous, then you can heal your loved one. That's when God will answer your prayers. And she was so frustrated that there were people who could take this one passage of scripture and basically it would strip away all the other grace and mercy and love of God. And they would point to themselves inside and no condemnation instead of grace, and pain and suffering instead of hope and love and healing. And we do this with many passages of scripture. We lose the meaning of the whole gospel because we take one or two little proof texts out and say, aha, and then we don't take into account that the picture is much greater and the discussion is far more reaching. And we do lose often grace and love because that seems to be the price we pay. When we forget the gospel message, then grace and love is what goes first. So with her experience in this hospice, it was just eye-opening about how important it is for us to hear all of this passage of scripture from James. Because James is not one to mince his words, as we have heard over the past few weeks, but he is also not one to withhold grace and mercy. As we have kind of marched through James, or perhaps as James has marched over us, we understand that James really does emphasize the sovereignty of God and the relationship that we have with God and one another, and how important that is in our lives. And so rather than take out one verse of this whole powerful letter, we hear it as a simple part of a whole. And when put with the rest of this passage, we see that this isn't a passage to be used to condemn ourselves or others. It is a passage full of hope and assurance and can help us build relationship with God and each other as a community of faith. And the truth he is leaving us with, after all we've heard, is truly remarkable and grace-filled. These are actually James' closing thoughts of his letter. There is not a give my regards to John and Lucy and that sort of thing, and I'll be there to visit you soon. There's nothing like this. These are his closing thoughts that he is leaving the recipients of this letter with. And so he is telling us that God is sovereign and God is compassionate. He reminds us, and he has written about the fact that God needs to be central to our relationships with one another in the ways we speak about and to each other, in the ways we treat each other. We are to be a community focused on God and with God, but also with each other. And one of the ways that we build this relationship and this sense of community is through prayer. When we pray to God, quite simply, we are communicating with God. We are speaking with God. Perhaps sometimes we're crying or laughing with God, but it's the way we communicate. And so James writes and says, we all have a reason to pray. It doesn't matter what's going on in your life, you have a reason to pray. If you're suffering, pray. If you're happy, pray. In our daily lives and in our relationship with God, pray. We share with God and God hears our prayers, and this affects change in our hearts, in our minds, in our spirits, and even, James says, in our bodies. We pray throughout the day, speaking with God about what we experience, and that reminds us that God is with us always, that we are never left alone, that God is walking with us, at times carrying us. And speaking with God about what we experience reminds us always that God is with us. Through good and bad, through suffering and happiness. Now prayer, as I mentioned, obviously is how we communicate with God, but prayer is also how we can communicate with each other. It's how we build community within the church. So in our daily lives, we may pray privately. You know, if you get up in the morning and you have your prayers, you go to bed at night, you have your prayers, or some maybe in the middle of the day before your meals, whatever. You know, you pray individually and privately, and that's wonderful. That's very important. But it's also very important for us to pray together as the church. We pray together as a group, and it brings us into deeper fellowship and communion with each other. But not just in worship services do we do this, although that's very important. The idea is that prayer with and for one another is critical in our lives together because we open ourselves up to one another. We let one another in. We say, I trust you enough to pray for me over this particular issue. And so, James says, when you're sick, call for people to gather and actually make physical contact with you. You know, the laying on of hands, anointing with oil. It's that reminder that we are present with you, and as we are present with you, God is with you as well. One of the most devastating things about this COVID pandemic has been how isolated we have been. Especially when people have been sick. That's the time when we really need to feel like someone is with us. My office manager that was in Rolla, she and her husband both had terrible COVID, and he ended up in the ICU, and the nurse actually called. No one could go in and see him. It was back in the early days when there was absolutely no way you were getting in to see a COVID patient. And the nurse manager actually called and said, it is critical for you to come in and see your husband because I think he's giving up. And we're about to have to make the decision to put him on a ventilator. And so I've spoken to the board. I've gotten doctor's permission. You can come in for 15 minutes, but you're coming in because he needs to remember he's not alone. And she went in. She took pictures of her children, of her grandchildren, talked to him for 15 minutes. And the nurse called back a couple of hours later and said, his numbers are good enough, we don't have to put the vent on him. We need each other, that physical reminder that we are not alone. And she was there to be able to pray with him and touch him and remind him that in this life there is more than just the moments of sadness and grief and heartache. We are not meant to be alone, and there are times whenever we desperately need prayer with and from our community of faith. It can be critical to our physical, mental, and spiritual well-being. One commentator writes that in James, prayer is not a private matter. Instead, it helps to shape a particular kind of community in which people are committed to each other. The sick call for elders to pray for them. Sinners confess to one another. The cheerful sing. For James, the community that prays together stays together, which is no small feat when there are so many things that can divide a community, many of which he has addressed throughout the book of James. Once again, we cannot escape that for James, authentic community rests in our understanding that God is the one who calls us together even in our differences. In our communal prayers, we express our needs for God and help in our lives. And we also offer thanks for the blessings that we receive. We pray for others, we're concerned for their well-being and all of that sort of thing. And as we do this, it helps us to remember that I am no better than you, and you are no better than me, because we all need prayer. It helps us do away with the hierarchies that James reminds us are so damaging in the church. We can pretend our lives are absolutely perfect and we don't have a care in the world, but we know that that's foolish. And James, if you'll remember, does not want us to be foolish. And he keeps reminding us, along with a lot of other New Testament writers, that the way we grow together with the church is to be real with one another, is simply to be real human beings before God and each other, which is wonderful when life is going our way and we don't have anything to complain about, and we are more than happy to share how grand life is. Let me just tell you all of the wonderful things that are happening in my life. But whenever life is not so easy and not going so well, and when we may need prayer to really help us through when we are sick or when we are grieving, when we are facing the struggles of mental health issues or financial issues or those sorts of things, we tend not to open up about that. We tend to want to be very private and not share our business with everyone else. And we think we can handle things on our own, and we're just going to let it play out, and we can handle it. According to James, though, this is not good for us. We need each other. We need to be authentic with ourselves and admit that we need help, and to understand it's okay to ask for it. It's okay to ask for support. It's okay to say, I'm struggling. It's okay to acknowledge the good and the bad in our lives. And when we do that, we may actually realize that we do benefit from the support of a church family, that we don't have to carry every burden, that we may not be as adept at hiding our troubles as we thought we were. So allowing ourselves to be vulnerable and ask for help actually helps us, enables us to receive the grace of Christian fellowship. It also helps us to understand how important it is for others. If we benefit from it, then we see how important it is for us to share when someone else needs it. We can have that empathy experience and know how important it is When someone says we need help, the courage it takes them to first of all admit it, and then second of all, that we can be the ones to bring encouragement. Relying on each other is not a sign of weakness. It's actually a sign of strength and faith. It's one of the greatest strengths of a healthy church to be able to pray and rely on each other. Several years ago, a colleague of mine was diagnosed with a very serious illness. And she was going to have a very long road to recovery. There were lots of doctor's appointments. There was lots of treatments. And there was going to be a great deal of exhaustion and side effects from what she was going through. Now, she shared this in a clergy group and swore us to secrecy. And she said that she was, at the time, she was not going to tell her congregation about her illness. She would plan her work week around her doctor's appointments, schedule her treatments on Monday so she would be fine by Sunday, and the congregation would never need to know. Well, we all just sat there for a second, stared at her, processed the stuff that was going on, all that she had just said, and when we finally had the wherewithal to speak again, we were supportive of her and the illness that she was facing and what she was facing, but then we also encouraged her to rethink her decision to keep it a secret. She would need the church to support her. She was not going to be in control of her life the way that she thought she was going to be in control. She had no idea how all of this was really going to impact her life. And what's more, she stood in the pulpit and she preached about the power of prayer. She encouraged her congregation to pray with and for one another and to care for each other and to open up and to be an authentic community. And so what would happen if her parishioners discovered her illness, because it was a small town and no one had a secret in that town? What would happen to the relationship between she and her congregation if they realized she did not trust them enough to open up and that she really didn't practice what she preached? How could they trust her if she didn't trust them? Thankfully, I think once the initial shock of her diagnosis wore off, she did open up to her congregation. And ultimately, it was a life-saving decision. The congregation was able to support her as she needed. Colleagues were able to fill in for her at a moment's notice because there were times when she would wake up just unable to come to church. She was able to experience the grace of healing and wholeness in her mind and body and spirit through the support of her church family. And even though vulnerability was a struggle for her, the community acknowledged this, respected it, and was there for her as she needed them to be. The body of Christ came together through prayer as they prayed for her healing and wholeness and then were able to minister to her through their gifts of food, walking the dog, all of those sorts of things, those little things that make our life worth living. Now, in congregations this size, I realize it may be difficult for us to stand up and just air our dirty laundry to everybody. I get that. But that's one reason why James says, call the elders. Call in a group of people whose faith you know. Call in those whom you trust will pray for you and allow your community to hold you up through difficult times. Sweet family, we are not alone in this life, but God is with us and we are with God. And God invites us to share our lives with Him. We are called to be a church that prays together so we can stay together. Because, quite simply, we love and care for each other, and we support one another as God has done the same for us. And in this, we experience the true grace of being part of the family of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. At this time, I invite you to stand with me as we affirm our faith together. And today we will once again use a portion of the brief statement of faith. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. At this time, I would invite you to join with me in a prayer of thanksgiving and dedication for the offerings we have received this week. Blessed be the Lord, for God is good, and God's love endures forever. Our Creator, help us to mirror your goodness through this offering in the world. Amen. And let's remain standing as we sing our closing hymn. Just a reminder, as we're behind these masks, be sure to say hello to everyone. You don't know if there's a visitor behind there or an old friend. So please greet one another. Take the time to say hello. Also, if you are visiting with us this morning, please see an usher and we can get you a welcome packet. We are so glad that you joined us here this morning. I am still learning people's faces and names, so, you know, that's just the reality. But we're glad that you all were here this morning. As you go from here, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.